I'm Anne Graham from the Catalyst Project, an engaged research university, and that this seminar is part of the Engaged University series. So I'm just going to say that it's a real pleasure to introduce today's speaker. Erinma Ochu is a Wellcome Trust Public Engagement Fellow, which is a lovely wide remit, and we'll see from her conversation today that that covers an awful lot of bases. And specifically today, she's going to talk about this idea of citizen-led innovation. So without any further ado, I will just simply hand over to Erinma. I see the rest of the team has just arrived. Perfect timing. Wait, off you go.
Hello, thanks so much for inviting me. It's really exciting to come to a place where the first thing you see are the words Open University. For me, that puts a smile on my face, so I'm really excited to be here to share some stories with you, personal stories about how I got to where I got to. So my background is originally in neuroscience. So I trained as a neuroscientist at the University of Manchester, and I've just really been led by my interests and my passions. So kind of three steps really in my career. So I kind of worked as a biomedical scientist, and then I was interested in that, but there was something about working in the lab that made me realize I might never see sunlight and I might never see people. And pivotal moment for me was I was working on Parkinson's disease. It was at the end of my PhD, and I was looking for a job outside of academia, but still linked to it, because I was still passionate about science. And I was interviewed by a number of people, British Library, Parkinson's Disease Society, and on that panel was someone who had Parkinson's disease. And that was the first time that I'd ever met anybody, and I'd been studying this disease, and this person was on the panel deciding kind of my immediate future, and whether I'd get a job looking at academic papers that might be relevant to people with Parkinson's disease. And the kind of thing that really struck me in one meeting this guy for the first time was thinking that some of the things that we were discovering as neuroscientists looking at cell death in Parkinson's disease would have no impact on this guy. And that really kind of shaped me in my thinking and in terms of how I needed to work for some kind of higher purpose in terms of me being involved in science. And that led me into science communication. So I worked on that project with the public, with this lay audience for several years. And it was a joy, actually, because what I had to do was to find articles that a patient group were interested in, patient and carers, and to summarise these in kind of lay language, in ordinary English. And it took a while for me to kind of be able to speak English and write English. And I really, my language was shaped by working with that group. So just a really simple example. We talk often in science about animal models. But to one person in that group, I was talking about a mouse model. And this lady was saying to me, "I remember that mouse seems very busy. It seems to be involved in all of these experiments." So that made me really think about what I thought was kind of lay language and how I really had to listen to, one, what people were interested in, and two, the way in which I turned that into ordinary language. And then kind of my next career jump really was thinking that I wanted to communicate science to a broader audience. And part of that, I think, with science, it's practice-based as well as theoretical. And part of that, I was really fortunate at the end of my PhD to work on the Christmas lectures. I don't know if anyone still watches them, but this is kind of about 10 years ago. And the bit that I was really interested in is the bit where you make things that demonstrate scientific concepts. So doing things like figuring out how a kidney works and things like that, but being able to show that to an audience of school kids. And I found that really exciting. It had to work in 3 minutes, and sometimes it wouldn't work. And actually having that time pressure to be able to make something that could demonstrate a concept and sometimes be an experiment really gave an insight, I think, to the kids that were watching the program as to how science works and sometimes how it doesn't work. And so that kind of led me on a different direction. And then I guess my kind of third hop was that I left science altogether. And I've always been interested in filmmaking and photography, and thinking about neuroscience, really I wanted to study neuroscience because I was interested in people and psychology and what drives us as human beings. And I thought neuroscience sounded like the degree that would kind of give me those insights. It wasn't. And so filmmaking, I thought, would be the... I should have studied psychology, actually, but never mind. So filmmaking and thinking about stories and telling stories was what led me into making films, taking pictures. And I worked in the film industry for about 5 years, which nearly killed me. Long hours, just like science. And that kind of led me to work in the art for 5 years. So before I kind of get into me getting onto citizen-led social innovation, it would be really great to have a sense of where people are working yourselves, which areas that you're working in. And because I'd really like you to use this seminar as an opportunity to think about your own work and where you are in your career, your own passions, if you could get rid of your computers for a minute. Grab a pen. And if you have got paper, no one's got paper. Okay, we can use this paper here. What I'd like you to think about, beyond your career, what your passions are, and it might be that actually your career is your passion. That's fine. So, and I'd like you to kind of open up this creativity by, if you're right-handed, use your left hand. If you're left-handed, use your right hand. I'll start it off. And just draw a little quick sketch of yourself and a couple of your passions. So I'll do me, and let's see if we can maybe get ourselves all on here. So I'll draw myself. No need to be precious. I know I've got small ears, there they are. And I love taking pictures. And I love the brain, but that's there. Cool, so that's me. If anyone else wants to come up and do that, please feel free. It would be great to see kind of what people's passions are and get a chance to... Hey, Martin. So I'll just, if you want to give it a go.
I've got to use my right hand if I'm left-handed, right?
Yep. Anyone else want to give it a go? Just so we can see who's in the room.
Music.
Music, excellent. Anyone else? And we've... Okay, so we've got a spare one here, if anyone wants to have a go over there. A few more people. Like if you can find a way for it to. Okay, good. Mountain climbing, okay. Is this cities, somebody? Yes, okay. So what we're doing for anyone that was late is kind of bringing on our passions and getting a bit of creativity going. Singing, all right, I love singing as well. Singing in a community choir, might talk about that. What else have we got? Music, drama, writing?
Writing.
Mountain climbing. Okay, more music, books. Great, fantastic. If anyone feels like they want to add to it, you know, go ahead. Don't let me stop you. I'm based at University of Manchester now, and I'm often based between the interface of kind of working with universities and working with the local communities. And the bit, I worked on a project maybe about 5 years ago called Manchester Beacon for Public Engagement. And the bit that I really enjoyed about that project was that we were trying to get universities, Manchester, Salford and MMU, to work more closely with their local communities, because I saw that as a kind of a driver for researchers to engage with the public. I thought that kind of was kind of straightforward, especially when in Manchester we are surrounded by very creative, but some people might describe very deprived community neighbourhoods directly adjacent to the university. So I thought this was, you know, thinking about what could we do together to innovate how people lived directly close to the university and, you know, work with our nearest neighbours, because we weren't doing that. So I saw this as a great opportunity. And it wasn't really until the end of that project that I realised the bit that I really enjoyed was university and community partnerships that had been working together for years. And they were just out there doing it. They didn't care about this culture change project. They'd been doing it year on, year out. That's just what they did. And it was really embedded in what they did. And I was really interested in that. And so my kind of next leap was to work at Lancaster University, where we were working on a project that spanned several different disciplines, looked at social and environmental challenges, so challenges that university might face, but also you could see them as societal challenges, and that we would work with local communities to solve those problems. But the communities would come up with the ideas as to how we might approach and solve some of those challenges. So I was really excited about that, because we were in the School of Computing, but we worked across several disciplines. So there was social scientists, many social scientists, people that worked on environmental science, biomedical. It was a real mixed bag of people. And the main goal really was about solving those social challenges. But because it was EPSRC funded, so Engineering Physical Science Research Council, one of the things was that we were trying to look at how novel technology could help facilitate social change or environmental change. And often there was a tension between what a community might see as novel and what the university would see as novel, and what novel technology is. I could see that there was this challenge that we were faced in almost every project. Whilst we had these really innovative ideas about how we could solve these big challenges, there were really small problems that kind of accumulated over time. So for example, in some community organisations, it might be that their technology was actually a bit crap. And why are we doing novel technology when actually we just want some technology that works? And so there were some things actually that had to be negotiated to make that project work, to build capacity and think about, you know, if I'm a community organisation, is working with the university going to take me a little bit off mission? So things like that. And then that was a part-time job. And at the same time as doing that, madly, I worked on a citizen science project that was all about patterns in sunflowers. And I'll just show you a little video to get a flavour of that. So this project's called Cheering Sunflowers.
So you saw these patterns of numbers in plants.
That's right.
And that was amazing, because those aren't just numbers plucked from the air, those are numbers that mathematicians know about and have got a name for, called Fibonacci.
We've got people growing sunflowers all over the world, and here in Manchester.
Imagine a city full of yellow sunflowers. I mean, the visual impact is going to be incredible.
And that's it. Now you're ready to grow a cherry sunflower.
Thank you.
absolutely massive, especially compared to all of the ones at school. These are some my six or more, building outside our front door. Growing taller and taller every day, and have a beautiful fancy cupcake.
We are glad to be part of Alan Turing's fun from Jamaica, our home in the sun.
We are hoping to come to the Museum of Science and Industry in the autumn to count some heads.
Okay, so you might have picked up a little bit of maths there, serendipitously, I don't know. But let's get back to what I think. Yeah, okay. So citizen science is where the public participate in science, usually as volunteers, and they're helping solve a scientific challenge. For me, with this sunflower project, one of the things to make it successful, we were trying to collect lots of data. We were replicating an experiment that Alan Turing had done in the 50s. And the idea was that we wanted to check in the reliability of that data and expand that data set, because sometimes you don't always get what these Fibonacci numbers in sunflowers. If you collect enough data, you can sometimes see number patterns that might not already be known to mathematicians. So that was the idea. Let's work with the public. Jonathan Swinton, the computational biologist who had this idea, said, why don't we, in Turing's centenary year, 2012, why don't we do an experiment and involve school kids in this? And I was kind of thinking, yeah, that's interesting, but why don't we just involve everybody in that, because we need to get lots of data. And to get that data, we needed people to grow sunflowers. So my challenge as kind of the project manager on this project was that I couldn't always see what people were doing. Did they know how to grow sunflowers? I didn't. And so it was kind of being able to work with other expertise. So, you know, gardeners, mathematicians, technologists to help us kind of create the platforms to collect the data. And so that what was really interesting and kind of what I learned from this particular project was that people did amazing things outside of just collecting data, because people just love sunflowers and people just loved Alan Turing. And they loved, there was something about the injustice that he suffered as a mathematician who was homosexual. And I didn't realize really how much this particular project struck me as an individual, because, you know, I'm gay, and one of the reasons that I wanted to work on this project was because this was a gay mathematician. That's not something that we talked about in school. This was a real opportunity for me as a citizen who was passionate about this to work on that project. And that it wasn't just about doing a maths project. So one of the things I like to think about when thinking about citizen science is there are all these different forms that can spring up in terms of your methods. So, you know, you could be using games. That wasn't really appropriate with this project. You could be looking at the kind of scientific concepts and come up with different research questions, sometimes using theatre. You might write some research papers. One interesting that often happens is that people will do their own experiments. So the kind of DIY bio, opening up the practice of science and trying to innovate in that way and being more open in that way of working. So there's a lot of scientific literature out there at the moment which looks at the value of citizen science to scientific discovery. It's particularly in terms of environmental science. So it's been very helpful that scientists can't collect all of this data in monitoring the environment ourselves. So we've been working with the public to collect that data. And the thing that really influenced me when I worked on this beacon project a while back was Carolyn Kagan's work at MMU, and this idea of working at the edge, so in between community and public, where kind of new forms of expression, new resources might spring up through collaborating. So not just your resources, but how they mix with other people's resources. So this kind of edge effects, it comes from ecology. So if you think about some trees separated by a field and some more trees, that bit in the middle, the grassland, often the path that we as humans might raise out the grassland, is the edge. And so what I'm interested in is how we populate this kind of edge between community and university, because I think that's where the innovations happen. And that is what sort of shifted me into this thinking about citizen-led perspectives, where I'm not thinking about myself as the expert who works in the university, but that I come maybe as an informed citizen and might apply my resources in this play space, if you like. And that's why I'm really interested to know what your passions are, and hopefully we can feed some of that in to thinking about how this might apply to your work. So, let's see, where are we? All right, so the Sunflowers Project was run by a bunch of people. These were the kind of main partners. Mosey, Science Festival, Manchester University, and Manchester City Council. And it started as a project that was meant to just be in Manchester. But with the internet, you know, as you saw, there was that song from Jamaica. There were people in Palestine growing sunflowers. And when I saw that on Twitter, I was like, oh my goodness, we need a map. And that's where I saw that we had these people involved from all over the world. So the idea with that project was to crowdsource a big data set, and specifically, for some reason, to engage people in Greater Manchester, so they would get involved. And there was some learnings around, you know, what's Alan Turing's legacy and how these number patterns work in sunflowers. And then for Mosey, they really were keen on having big media stories. But just thinking about some of the facts and figures, when we look back at the project, it had a big media reach, it got lots of coverage on TV and in the papers and so on. But one of the things that I thought would be really interesting is not just to crowdsource the data set, but why don't we apply crowdsourcing to telling stories about that project? And so that I could kind of get into people's homes and see what were their challenges with developing, growing their sunflowers. 2012 was not a good year for growing sunflowers. It was a really bad summer. But what was wonderful about that is part of the submission process was that you had to submit a good photograph. And so we had to practice to take pictures. And so people were taking pictures and uploading them to Flickr. And the way I saw it, the sunflowers and those pictures and those videos were their pictures, but they could donate them through Creative Commons to the experiment. And so anyway, so all this kind of stuff happened. But I thought the really interesting thing was that people just, without kind of prompting, people just wrote about the project. So there were 40 blogs out there where people just writing about the project and their perspectives on it. And people were pledging data from all over the country. Whether they collected that was another matter. But there were a whole host of partners that were involved in the project. And I like to work in quite an emergent way. So all of these partners came on at different points during the project, and many of them, for me, were to solve challenges that I might have. So the National Trust, for example, they've got a gardener who she knew about how to grow sunflowers. So did Jodrell Bank, so they could advise the project about how to do that. But they also wanted to host events themselves. The STEM Ambassadors Programme, they could get the project into schools and think about teachers creating learning resources. Wonderful thing, actually, from the RSA, they have this small fund called Catalyst, and usually with research money, you can't really spend it on equipment that you give away to people. You have to account for that or just say, oh, we lost it. But what they enabled us to do was to leave a bit of a legacy with some of those community groups that weren't gardening, but might be working, say, with homeless people. To be able to buy tools for people to get involved in the project that way. Manchester City Council provided seeds. Who else was there? Oh, these guys, Twig, donated their learning resources. Open Data advised us on how to open up the data. Eastland Homes, social housing in Manchester, enabled us to get into housing estates across Manchester to get their tenants involved in the project, but also not really necessarily about collecting data, but having, you know, fun events and fun days that they put on. So with Eastern Homes, the thing they wanted to do was to make a float for Manchester Day Parade. And what was really nice about it, you know, was that when they came to sharing that with us, oh no, it's not there. One of the really nice things, actually, that made me realise, okay, they've understood this project, was that they had the Fibonacci numbers alongside on the float, and they were the right numbers. So I was thinking, okay, they kind of got it. It was good. So anyway, the point was that we used all of these partners to solve challenges that I had in trying to get this project off the ground. And we worked with BBC Outreach to help crowdsourcing those stories, so those short videos that you saw embedded in that story. But these are some of the other things, wonderful things actually, that people did with their data, or, you know, so we've got this knitted Fibonacci topper for people if they're going out in the garden. Someone made a cake, and I asked them, you know, how did you manage to fit the right number of spirals around your sunflower cake? And they're like, well, it's math, stupid. You know, so, and then people were able to make learning resources quicker than I could. So Isabel, this top left there, this is her method for counting the spirals. And people, you know, people appeared in their pictures. Subi at the bottom and Ben from Spearfished, a collective of artists, they came along and planted sunflowers at Museum of Science and Industry, and they were inspired by the project and when they built this giant baby that was meant to celebrate Alan Turing being involved in computing, they put this giant sunflower head on the baby that marched through Manchester and 30,000 people saw it. And so there are all the, kind of these different creative approaches that people applied. And then it was interesting, the evaluation that Sally Fort did to look at what people did. It's about 110 people that were surveyed. And so some of the things that people did, you know, they spread the word, they grew sunflowers, some people wrote blog posts, they held events. And then you can't really see it on this, but there were some other people who put on their own experiments. So they would go out and get involved in bee counting or insect counting and then submit that to the environmental monitoring programs. So people were doing their own thing as well as helping us, and I thought that was really interesting. I got my choir involved, so I was singing at a community choir called Open Voice, and the choral director there, she composed a song that used Fibonacci numbers as part of that, and so people could go away from the results understanding what Fibonacci numbers might sound like. So that was a lot of fun. And this is my gay pride costume that someone gave me. It was celebrated as part of Pride as well. So those kind of, what really for me was not so much about the science behind the project, but the feelings that it gave me in terms of the experiences, the moments that happened on that project, which really has shaped me, I think. And so now I've got this Wellcome Trust Engagement Fellowship. It's 2 years, I'm kind of at my one year in, I've got a year left. So if you think about it in story terms, I'm at that point where you're thinking, what the hell am I doing? but what's been really nice is working with other researchers. So I've been working with historians and geographers and social scientists to learn some of the tools of the trade that you could work on if you work on interdisciplinary projects. And that has presented some challenges for me, because supposedly you're meant to be this expert now in engagement. You know how to engage the public. But actually now you have to engage other researchers, and we speak different languages, and we work in different ways, and we have different tools and different techniques. How do you work with that? And again, I think it's been going back to thinking, well, what is the social or the environmental impact that we're trying to have on this project, and how can we sort out how we work together in order to make a difference to the people that we're trying to work with to solve some of those problems. And often there's never enough money to get people involved in it in the way you'd like to get them involved. So another project was called Everyday Growing Futures, and this was all about kind of open data and how you could use open data to explore different ways that you could map spaces where you might grow food. So in Old Trafford, there are three parks, they're quite green, but I live in Old Trafford, and what was interesting with this is having a project that's on your doorstep. This really makes you think about how you're going to engage in that project, because the legacy is with you and with your neighbours, and you live there. So that really shaped, you know, thinking about communities of interest. Suddenly, you're, again, this informed or uninformed citizen working on a research project. You have to work in a particular way. So again, this really shaped my thinking. So there was some, we went out and we mapped spaces. We worked with two organisations, the Kindling Trust in Manchester. No, go ahead. The Kindling Trust in Manchester, and they're all about feeding Manchester and encouraging people to grow and feed the city. And the project was paralleled in Sheffield. And so there was this idea of looking at innovation in one place and seeing how it could spread to Sheffield. So there was this sharing that went on between two cities. And I should say the project was led by Farida Viz at the University of Sheffield. So now he's kind of working University of Manchester with researchers in Sheffield, which is always a challenge, I think, for big research organisations because they're thinking, whose impact is it? And I'm kind of like, well, actually, does that matter? Does that stop us from doing the projects? And so we were looking at how we could use technology again to map out spaces where we could grow land. And there were, again, a number of project people involved in that project. It was funded by Communities and Culture Network Plus. And the nice thing about it, I think, is that you have these networks that come together that, and they don't mind that community organisations can be part of your projects. Let's have a look, where are we? Now, who was it who said that they like music? Okay, so this one's for you. So the next project that I wanted to kind of share with you was all about what makes music catchy. Now, I don't know if you have your own theories about what makes a catchy tune. So something that's going to be really memorable and you're going to remember it from now until the rest of your life. Any theories around what makes a hook?
Emotion.
Rhythm. What else?
An event.
An event. So something that happens around hearing that piece of music. Others? No? Okay, so this is the way that I like to work is to try and make, I try and make films to get my head around things. And I think if you're doing something to do with music, music's all about movement, really, isn't it? So let's go. Oh, it's got this thing again where it's not.
You let the dogs out!
It's just everything, the introduction just grabs all of you, makes it fun, makes you want to, oh, what's coming next?
We knew that, like, that bit, that sort of thing.
Love me tender, love me true. Glad all over, yes, I'm a. Din diddle din 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 diddle din din. Ice, ice, baby. Ice, ice, baby.
For me, it's the oomph bit.
The oomph bit.
So this was to try and, the idea was to have a game. So John Ashley Burgoyne, scientist at University of Amsterdam, had this fantastic idea where they have a game that you can try and look and see where you think is the catchiest bit in a tune. But we kind of thought we also need to kind of get that concept out there and start talking about it and let people's ideas shape the research questions. So I don't know if people have heard of big data and collecting lots of data sets. One of the nice things about big data is that you can look for stories in the data and you can ask kind of emergent questions. So you can find patterns in the data that you might not have originally thought might exist. So your hypotheses could kind of go out the window and you find new ones. But because with music, everyone's got something to say about music. You know, my brother's a DJ. I told him I was doing this project and he's like, Rimmer, he's in Copenhagen, he's like, come to my nightclub, I'll show you where the hook is. You know, you scientists, there's no way that you're going to be able to understand about hooks. And he really brought something interesting to the project. So did other DJs. So he played me three tunes that had the same element in them, but they'd been remixed several times over. So one was a house track, one was a soul track, and one was a hip-hop track. And what was amazing about that was he was saying, see, look, sometimes the hook is not always the hook. And I could just say to the researchers, there you go, have a look at that. So this gave us this sense that people had their own questions, again, about this particular experiment, and that there's another way to engage people, not just in doing collecting lots of data. So we are making a game for that particular project. And again, it's with the Science Festival. When I tried to, I thought, I have to be able to explain this project to really young kids as well, because they come up with fantastic ideas. Their brains aren't strapped by our own inhibitions that we might have. And so I couldn't explain it in words. So we thought, okay, what could we come up with to put across this concept? So one of the challenges was the Science Festival said, you know, this experiment is for 14 upwards. Anyone under there? No, not involved. And so we wanted to prove to the Science Festival director that kids under 14 could understand the concept. So this is my niece and nephew, and they've given their permission to show this because they want the whole world to see it anyway. And so this is what they came up with to demonstrate that they understood the hook.
Con los
Okay, so we had a lot of fun making that video. We probably made it about 4 or 5 times. And the beauty of these kinds of experiments and coming up with these concepts is that you really have to engage with people to make that video. So if you look at our outtakes, you realise when you make a Harlem Shake video, I don't know if anyone's made a Harlem Shake video. Has anyone made one? It's a really fun thing to do, okay? and I really admire people that have done it with a lot of people, because you have to do it in silence and play the track. You put the track on afterwards, and so you're having to coordinate in such a way that you're editing and all this kind of thing. And we did it on an iPad, and I was really naff at working the iPad, and my little niece was like, give it to me, you do it like that, there you go. I was like, all right, wow. So you're being able to foster these kind of skills and hidden talents that people might have to help you come up with this way of working. And then we could show that to Science Festival. And what was really fascinating as well was that Lance, my nephew, he went to his dad and said, I remember doing this experiment, it's all about the hook and what makes music catchy. And I hadn't told him that in so many words, but he couldn't talk about it until we'd made that video. So there's something in the making and the connecting and the doing of things, I think, that enables us to better understand concepts. And for me, I could better understand them as people and how I can creatively engage them in these things. So now, you know, as a result of this video, a show was put on for the kids at Museum of Science and Industry. So working with characters like Rasta Mouse. I don't know if anyone's got kids. Rasta Mouse, yes, okay. So there was other emergent things that came out of just creatively trying to get involved in what does this mean to people. So back to this. Yeah. So so what I'm trying to do is work across different cultural forms. I love to draw from what's out there in the world already to try and remix science with culture. So actually this is the Rasta Mouse show, which puts across some of the concepts. And the presenters, they're not scientifically trained, but what they're very good at is coming up with ways to demonstrate those scientific concepts around music and how music can be used to kind of organise people and things like that. They would build that into their script, and loads of people came to watch it. And then the other thing was thinking, we were trying to launch this project and there was no game, didn't exist. And so we had to launch it as a concept. And so with the team, we went to a silent disco. And I don't know if anyone's been to a silent disco, but you listen to the music of your past, and that's really what Hooked is all about, the tunes that you remember and recognise. And so you can listen to different decades. So what we did was crowdsource what people thought a catchy tune might be, and then we could play the results at a silent disco. So you could hear what the public thought was, and then you could come along and you could dance to the results. And the great thing about this for me was that the researchers and other researchers that worked on music, they came along, they did a little panel talk and stuff, and then we had this silent disco afterwards, which was a bit crazy. And then the researcher went back to Amsterdam, and over Christmas, he emailed me and he said, Erinma, I've written a research proposal, and it's all about silent disco as research method to look at pro-social behaviour. And this is what researchers do. We look at things and we think, oh, right, there's a research question in there somewhere and there's a method. So it's fantastic that he also got something out of this silent disco, which he thought was a little bit weird. He had fun, danced with the data and the participants. It was good. So it's thinking about that. But there are a number of ethical challenges. And this is what I wanted us to think about together that come when you work in this particular way. So I don't know about people here, but are you working alone, in single disciplines, or are you working across disciplines? Give me a show of hands if you're working in a single discipline. No, wow, hey, the world has changed. It's here at the Open University. Excellent. So people are working with different disciplines. And what about, are people working with community groups or community organisations and that kind of thing? Okay, so you'll be familiar with the kind of ethical challenges that might come up. And how you might experience those. So maybe we could have a chat about some of those challenges that come up when you work in this way that you're mixed in the middle and you're trying to do innovation at the edge. So let's think, maybe groups of about 4, if you could have a chat and think about some of the ethical challenges that might come up when you work in this remix way, remix culture, I would like to call it. So groups of 4, and let's give it about 15 minutes? Is that good? And then we'll feedback. You had a chance to chat. So what I'm going to do is ask each group to feedback a challenge that they came up with. And if you see that challenge has come up already, think you have to give me another one. Okay? So, who wants to start off? And say your name, because I don't know if you all know one another. Do you? Yeah? Okay, so say your name. So, who wants to start? Which group wants to start? Okay, we'll start over here.
Sure, I can start with the crowdfunding point, which is with research being crowdfunded for, say, civic crowdfunding projects or things like that. So funding coming from multiple sources as opposed to one research grant, and kind of the ethics of feeling responsible to different funding bodies, whether individuals or groups.
So there's an agenda to the money.
Right.
And is there something also about the ethics of where the money comes from, I suppose? So there's the there's the money. Whose money is it? And what do those funders want, I guess? Okay, cool. Another one? What about this group? Oh, and what was your name?
Alex.
Alex, cool.
We talk about different things. Someone proposed the problem of classical privacy when it gets into sharing data or even processing them.
What's your name?
Carlos, my name is Anna. and then we had another one was about issues of idea ownership in co-creation processes. So when we get to co-create things, it's difficult to trace where ideas come from.
Who owns what? Mm-hmm. Can you own an idea?
That's even ethics.
Another.
We talked about expectations. I suppose it comes back to what you were saying earlier on about expectations, about this is going to be innovation, what innovation is, but also pace of how you're developing things. Universities and outside in the real world go at a completely different pace, schools, yeah. We were talking about. And I think that comes back to privacy and ethics. We were talking about expectations of the academic understanding of ethics and what it is in the real world, and privacy invasion in the real world compared to what we think of it as. They don't get as wound up about some things that academics get wound up about. And similarly, we don't get as wound up about things that they would go, well, that's unacceptable. There's a discourse, you know, a discord there.
What's your name?
Anne.
More Anne's.
Yeah, just call everybody Anne,
see. We're all Anne now. I can see Anne dancing, yeah, cool. Okay, give us another one.
We were in the same group, yeah.
Yeah. You guys?
It's just about digital inclusion in rural areas and the difficulties. So about three to different level of literacy and the main what could be sustainability.
So inclusion and
digital inclusion.
Okay, digital inclusion. And then you talked. So were you talking about digital literacy?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. What's your name?
Helioma.
Oh, give me it again.
Helioma.
Again. Okay. Nice. Okay. These guys.
I mean, one of the issues, I guess, the ethical issues that we talked about. I'm Martin Reynolds, by the way. I don't know anybody here who answered your question earlier. Was a sort of ethical issue of equity. I guess the how you make transparent your role as a researcher as being something that's of a different status from the rest of the community with whom you are hoping to collaborate with. So that disparity of status, I think, is a continual tension that you have in can experience with yourself. Mm-hmm.
So one of the things I wondered about with these was what happens if you think about it from that I'm a citizen and you have some knowledge as a researcher. How might you then go about solving some of these challenges? There aren't answers necessarily, but one of the things that really informed my work when I started on my fellowship was, I don't know if you heard of it, ethical principles of community-based participatory research. So Professor Sarah Banks at the University of Durham had worked for many years with different communities, and they'd come up together with a set of principles. They called it kind of everyday ethics. And what was really nice was that she offered that people could use these principles to reflect on past work that you've done, to think about the kind of everyday ethics of your work. So I reflected on the Turing Sunflower Project, thinking about some of these principles. So I just wanted to share that work with you. And it's not to say that these principles solve all the problems. It doesn't, and it's still difficult, and it's sometimes you can't solve the problems. But it gives you a different way of thinking about it. And so I found it really useful in my work. And the Lancaster group at Catalyst, they use these principles to reflect on their work. And sometimes you kind of drift in and out of them. And when I feel like, where am I going with this? How can I solve this problem? Then I go back and I have a quick look at the principles, and it gives me a sense of, okay, that maybe I could just pick up the phone and talk to someone about it who's also working on the project. So I'll share those with you. So these are some of the ethical challenges that they came up with, and they published this together. With the group of community partners that they worked with. Thanks for that. So I think some of these things we came up with here, and these are the sort of challenges. And I think that there's this one, I struggle with it a lot, that when you're operating in this kind of middle space, the boundaries between you being a researcher, you sometimes being researched, being an academic, being an activist, you know, I'm really passionate about environmental issues. Whose agenda are you coming with in any particular moment? So many of these things we talked about, so privacy. And then this one came up, I think, so you mentioned it, didn't you? Yeah, just about the ethical review process versus what other people would think about as ethics. So they came up with this everyday ethics approach. That was thinking more about having a commitment to sharing power and resources and working towards beneficial outcomes. And so they came up with this. And it's a kind of attitude, ethos, way of working that you can try and embed in your research process. And you can find this online if you Google ethical principles. I've actually put it at the end of my slides. So my slides are on slideshow, and they're at the end of that. But I find them quite useful. So this thing about active learning, is there an opportunity where you can be encouraging that people are learning a new skill on a project or something they've always wanted to try and do? So I usually ask a question, if you could wake up tomorrow, what would be a skill that you'd suddenly like to wake up with? If you think about that question, that gives you an indication of skills that you might want to foster, or people that you might want to partner with. So kind of building this in, I think I've always find this challenging. So kind of, how do you take collective action together? Someone talked about the pace of the kind of university versus communities. And sometimes that thing of taking collective action together can take a lot of time, so that we're all at the same point and we're ready to move forward. And I don't like it sometimes that with research, we're so slow, and people just want to make things happen. And so sometimes, actually, when you work in partnership, you can drive one another towards getting that collective action. I think it's all about getting a bit of a rhythm going. So those everyday ethics were something to think about. So these are just some of the references that have informed my work. But also to say, all of this is available on the internet anyway. I would say I'm a kind of generalist, and whilst all of these guys who are researchers have informed what I've done, there's many people that I've worked with that aren't researchers that have informed what I've done, and there are almost too many to mention. And so, you know, to all the people that collected sunflowers, the people that worked on all those other projects, the Kindling Trust, Grow Sheffield, people that have mentored me, you know, that they won't necessarily be encapsulated there. But, you know, thanks to them, and thanks to you guys for inviting me to come and talk. Yeah, go for it.
I mean, I think it works great. I mean, I've been working on this since the Beacon stuff, at least, you know. You're somebody who's been doing this for a long time, you've got all this kind of knowledge and skills and experience. Alongside you taking this agenda forward, obviously there's been this kind of big institutional kind of push towards this, policy push towards it. I'm curious about whether you think there's a danger that actually as an advocate for research or somebody who's willing to be researched, buying into all those ethical principles, there's a danger actually if people are pushed into this too unwillingly, that actually you find ourselves in a difficult situation where, you know, there's a tension there because the researcher doesn't take those kind of ethical principles on board. I mean, I'm kind of curious about how we try and address that, and to what extent on the Beacons you had a role of stopping that kind of work going forward as much as that became the good stuff.
I mean, it's a really good question. So one of the challenges with that Beacon project is that it was, you know, it was a government policy and kind of top down, and, you know, come on public, come on universities, you need to engage with the public. And my real challenge with it was, you know, it's an Einstein thing, you cannot change the culture from within the culture that you're in. There has to be something that drives the need and the desire for that change to happen. And so I was really uncomfortable with the idea, and I think universities, big institutions are good at this. They manage somehow to hold on to the money for themselves, to skill up all of their people, and to do very little in return for the communities that they work with. And so with these kinds of projects, there has to be this equity. And, you know, you're not gonna have, if you're coming with £1.2 million to change the culture, why do you need £1.2 million to change the culture? But me as an activist, I can think, well, this is an opportunity, actually. How can we work with local communities, develop partnerships, listen, go out, participate? Why do we have to create some new thing? What if we participated? So I would try and position it in that way. The challenge was that if you go on that journey too quickly, you are breaking off as a kind of activist contingent to that project. And so, you know, there were challenges in the project up in Newcastle and in Durham, where they started at community and university partnerships. You know, some of those universities, they weren't ready for that, because where they were is, you know, one way, disseminate our research. And so how do you build capacity on both sides? And you do have to start with where people are, whether that's the people that you're trying to engage outside of the university or the people within the university. So it's, you know, to me it's a journey. You can say life is a journey, and we don't do life in projects, right? And so for me it is about that longer term. What difference do I want to make in my lifetime? Not everybody thinks like that, but when you get to 40, you start thinking about it. And so I think these ethical principles are really important to embed within the culture. But you're right, there are tensions, and there always will be. Academia, if you think about values, what do we value in academia? A single, you know, the author. Whereas what I'm talking about Your element might not even be visible, but I like working like that. So, you know, if those papers have my name on, great. If they don't, they don't. But what I'm really keen on is that with, you know, fantastic, with during the Sunflower Project, everyone that registered and got involved in that project will be on that paper that's published. And so there's just, it's thinking about how you want to do that, or do you listen to what you're told? And, you know, the houses we live in, the institutions that we work in, they're in the 20th century. And so it's thinking, for me, it's thinking about what is that, doesn't have to be an institution, what's that temporary structure that you could work on that makes, that moves stuff forward?
It's interesting the way that you talk about everything as this sort of narrative of your journey. Mm-hmm. And through my journey into sort of public engagement work, I've given presentations where I've given that sort of narrative. Have you found that when you've presented this to some groups that you sort of were aware, you thought of them in a certain place with regard to their working with communities, but when you gave presentations, you realised that they were in a different place from the way that you thought that they were? It's just, it's happened to me, where I've gone to a community which I thought I knew, I've presented a sort of reflective type, exactly the way you've done, and they've all gone, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
And I thought that they were at a different point. Have you come?
I mean, I think it happens all the time. And then that's a challenge about me not really understanding where people are. And I just think you can never make assumptions. And so if someone says, what the hell are you talking about? I need to do damn well better to actually explain where I'm coming from, but also to really listen and to be open to influence. My story is my story. It's not necessarily anyone else's. So it's that, coming to a sense of understanding where we're coming from. And so, yeah, it happens a lot. I had a massive argument the other day with someone in the university. I mean, it wasn't an argument. It was just, sometimes I don't have patience. You know, I don't have patience to think that we go on a journey of trying to do kind of two-way engagement, and then we get to a point where actually, oh my God, we're still just disseminating our research. And that happens in pockets across the university. And we've had a beacon program and blah, 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 blah. And you kind of think, oh my God, but not everyone's going to be touched by the work that you do. And actually, having that conversation with that argument with that person, I know at some point we'll come back to another and we say, you know that thing we talked about? Let's talk about it some more. You don't always have that chance if you're just having a kind of one-off visit. But if people do have questions, please do, you know, contact me. Pick up the phone. The really nice thing about Turing Sunflowers was that people phoned me, or they sent me an email, or some people wrote me letters, and then that we'd have a chat. You know, math teachers who'd retired were like, wow, you know, this is really giving me a chance to think about this, that, and the other, but have you thought about this, Erinma? They were testing me, I loved it, it was fantastic. And sometimes, you know, where there's an argument, that can be the almost that best place for change to kind of come about. So yeah, I don't have all the answers. And every project, you've got to start from scratch.
So it's a bit of more like an open question. Obviously, I'm not expecting an answer. But one of the things that you were raising was, for example, tension between what the funders were expecting with respect to what you get, also the fact that tension between what typical practice among academics are with respect to, you know, how this clashes with these kind of projects that engage everyone, and then who becomes an author, and how do you get these things. So my question would be more from the side of, after you having done so many projects, I suppose that you've been facing this tension, possibly in the context of university. So my question would be, are you looking into ways to actually better, improve the way these organizations, in particular universities, kind of handle and evaluate researchers, or how they work in a sense, so that it becomes easier to run projects of this sort that could engage communities, and what sort of form that would take?
Yeah, I mean, so I think there's this thing about everyone being on the same page in a project, and for me, that's about how you engage people at the start. So, you know, I worked in the film industry. If you're making a film, the film has a vision. And you can either have that directorial, this is my vision, you're all going to do what you're told, make the film happen. Or you can do this thing where you develop a shared vision and shared goals and be okay with the fact that whatever you thought with the goal, if you come up creating that goal together, what might it be? So my position now is kind of thinking about from that centre point, so working from the edge, outside of the institution, outside of communities, but where themes that you might have could touch, and collecting stories. And then research projects might evolve out of that. Community project might evolve out of that. I don't mind, but to start off some conversations, to tell some stories, to find ways in which you can touch people. You know, on the Hooked project, what I really like about the research in Amsterdam is that he's like, yeah, of course, we put the data out there, it's Creative Commons. If people want to come and do interesting things with that data, they can do. But part of that approach is to invite people to do stuff with your data. So there's all kinds of technologies that can support that, but sometimes it's not that accessible. So you can use things like Figshare and Impact Story to put your videos out. You know, I use SlideShare to put my slides out. 40 people had looked at my slides before I even got here, which is like crazy, but it's really nice to think that people are looking. So I put it out there. You know, part of the reason that I said yes to doing this seminar is that you're filming it, and that it can be out there. I don't know if that answers your question.
It was partly. I was more kind of concerned about the inner workings of organisations, like for example, university.
Yeah.
That somehow. So, for example, we recently went through. Gone through this stuff as well, but you know, we're doing the evaluation of academics, and if an academic doesn't get, you know, his name on a number of papers,
yeah.
But that would actually prevent maybe getting more impact and doing actually something better in the real world than just because you'd rather stay in house and
So I guess what you're talking about is this idea that the currency of an academic right now is papers. And if you don't have those papers, you're not going to progress, you're not going to go up that hierarchy and da-da-da-da. But for me, I'm not in that game. Maybe I've got the luxury of not being in that game by having a fellowship. I recognise it. I could see the tensions in the Lancaster project, that the researchers, they're working this interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary space. You don't do that at the beginning of your career. It's like kind of career suicide almost. But it depends about you as a. It will reveal something about yourself in how you deal with that challenge. So that project's coming to an end now, and it'd be really interesting to see. Well, I can see how that has shaped those researchers. So some are going into teaching, some are going on to do other community university projects. It shaped those tensions are what shape you, and they feel like, oh my God, what a nightmare, you know. Computers where I work are just like, oh my God, what a nightmare. But I'm like, I'm not spending time on that. You know what I mean? And so I guess it's where you put your priorities longer term. So rather than thinking about it as this short term thing, thinking about it as, yeah, where do you see yourself in 5 years' time, in 10 years' time? Is your currency making a difference to society? And I think Southern universities, universities in the Southern Hemisphere, people go to universities there because they want to make a difference to their community. They want to take that knowledge back to their community to do things with it, to create social action. And because of where I came from, I was brought up in the East End of London by a single mother and her friends. I didn't know that I was in social economic crisis until I went to a public school where, you know, there's racism, there's all the rest of it. I didn't know, you know, so it's kind of about, do you choose to go to that institution that would value that way of working, where your citations can come after the social impact that you want to create? And that they're all interlinked, I think. And I think maybe it's moving beyond that thing of, you know, me, the I and the we, and there's that tension between if you work as an academic. But if you work on interdisciplinary projects, you know, there's a network of people that work in that way now. And if you have good PIs, they care about where the researchers will go. So I don't know if you have a mentor or a senior academic mentor about where your next journey might be, but I hear those tensions. And I fall into the trap of it all the time. Oh my God, I've not published in X number of years. But then I just think, actually, what is my real goal? And for me, it's not about getting academic publications.
Hi, I have a question. Yes, I liked a lot your presentation and the thinking about your title, social innovation. I'd like to understand a little bit the difference between social innovation and social engagement. For instance, in your project about the sunflower, you presented the big numbers of people sharing source, sharing photos, videos. And do you feel, if I'd like to know if you have published papers analyzing the innovation aspect, not only the engagement, if you could just, I know that's a complex question, but...
Yeah, so there was an independent review of the project. And one of the things that we're doing now is to look back at what motivated people to take part, to look at that kind of impact around social innovation. Because one of the things that really interested me was when I talked to people, they would say, there's one lady in South London, I said, why are you taking part in this project? And she wouldn't necessarily say this if she was just interviewed. But she said, you know, I want to get involved in this project because I want the fact that you're going to give people academic credits on a paper, I want to get involved because the teenage girls that I work with are getting pregnant at 16. If they get pregnant at 16, I want them to have some kind of academic credit. And whether the world kind of works in that way, that you get academic credit then means that you progress in life, that's what she thought. And so she was holding several events where people came and they counted sunflowers and it was a kind of drop-in, drop-out. So there was usually groups of one individual in a group that would encourage people to get involved. So that for her, that was that. There was a homeless organisation that we worked with, and it was just a bit of fun to get involved in the project. And people just like gardening. So people have got all kinds of different reasons to get involved in it. But the kind of, for me, the interesting bit was the things that people were doing themselves for themselves or for other people, not necessarily for the project. So for me, that's where the kind of the social innovation was, that people innovated away from the science of the project, and that you had this kind of cultural expression around the project. So it's going back and looking at that, but you know, I need to think about the best way to do that, bearing in mind this idea of to do that, it's an opportunity for others, not necessarily for myself. You know, what's the wider value of doing that work? If that makes sense, there has to be something benefit for the people that participate in that kind of impact research.
I think that this is a very important part, because if you are, you know, writing about your research, and then you can include this information as well. The social innovation for people. I don't know, to try to interview the participants after the project. How can you measure this social innovation? The initial interview after the Sunflower project, did you try to contact them again and check?
So we one of the things that we're trying to do is to stay in touch with people and to visit, go and see what people were doing. And then we did... an independent survey at the end of the project, but also had organisers to answer some questions. So that gave us some of the what else did people do and why. But, you know, what we want to do is go back and see what have people done next. And actually, maybe they haven't done anything, I don't know. But what I don't want that to be is just a research for research sake. It has to have some kind of value. So one bit of value might be that what else might people want to do with their photographs, with their data, with those kind of questions. You know, so one of the things that came up quite often was with teachers, they want better learning resources around number patterns, because it's quite difficult to teach Fibonacci numbers in schools. So this project was almost like a gift to them. And they went on and they shared their learning resources. So part of it is also putting that back out there, but obviously with their permission.
Thank you ever so much, and really, really interesting.
Thanks, Erinma.
Okay, pleasure.